So those of us who use the Ilizarov regularly are very comfortable with this, you know, three-dimensional thinking. And therefore, I'm going to try and explain what the concept of an oblique plane is for those of you who are not very sort of familiar with the Ilizarov, and try and tell you how we put the hinges onto that. So whenever you see something which shows you a deformity in the AP and shows you a deformity in the lateral, we conventionally we tend to call this a biplanar deformity, right? But if you think of it, a procurvated deformity is a deformity which is only in the sagittal plane, and a varus valgus deformity is a deformity which is only in the coronal plane. So what happens when you take an X-ray of a procurvatum deformity in the AP? What does it look like? It looks straight. And what happens when you take a varus valgus deformity, when you take a lateral X-ray of that? It looks straight, right? So the corollary from there is, if you image perpendicular to the plane of the deformity, you will see the maximum deformity. If you image in the plane of the deformity, you will see no deformity. So even a biplanar like this, if you are able to rotate it so that at one point you see no deformity. So now you are in the plane of deformity, and if you go 90 degrees to that, you see the maximum extent of the deformity. So these so-called biplanar deformities are actually uniplanar deformities, except that if you look at it end on, this deformity is not straight this way, it's not straight this way, it's in a plane which is oblique. And because we do all our imaging in anatomic planes, that is why we see this in both the X-rays. So what I'm going to talk about is one relatively simple way of finding out what is the plane of this deformity, and then how we use it to put on an Ilizarov fixator. So that is Ilizarov for some people. So if we go back to a little of the geometry which is related to the pre-construction of frames, if you have two lines, they will always define, if you have two points, they will always define a line. A line and one point can only define one plane. Okay, there's only one plane which is passing through either the three points or a line and a point. And you have to think of vertical planes, that is the coronal and sagittal. You also have to think of the transverse plane in which you get your rotation. When you do an AP X-ray, what you are imaging is the frontal plane. When you do a lateral X-ray, what you are imaging is the sagittal plane. And as we discussed, the varus deformity, the plane is frontal, but the apex is lateral. In a valgus deformity, also the plane is frontal, only the apex is medial. So varus valgus are both in the same plane, the apex is pointing different directions, same thing with the procurvatum recurvatum. Now one of the basic sort of concepts of the Ilizarov is the use of hinges. And here what we are talking about is the line which passes between these hinges. That is the hinge axis which is related to the cora. So you saw the earlier lectures which showed you the cora point. But the cora point is actually a line which is coming out of the screen. And because you are seeing it end on, you are seeing it as a point. But really speaking, it is an axis, it is a line. So if I had to tell you that this, my elbow, is in a deformed position, and getting it here is the straight position, right? So I have to move it from here to here. So to correct the deformity, this deformity is in which plane of this screen behind me, right? It's, this deformity, this is the plane of that screen, okay? To correct it, I have to move it in which plane? In the same plane, okay? But this movement is occurring with around an axis which is perpendicular to that plane. So that's a corollary, that correction or movement that you want to do happens in the plane of the deformity. The axis of correction is perpendicular to the plane of the deformity, and if you look at these hinge surfaces over here, the line which joins the center of these hinges is the hinge axis, and these surfaces are kind of parallel to the plane of the deformity, and this hinge axis is what passes through the Cora point, whether you draw it on the convex side or the concave side. Getting that hinge axis at the right point is what is the important thing. So there is another concept where we talk about the level of the hinge and the level of the osteotomy. If you have to make a so-called mistake, it's better to make it in the level of the osteotomy. If your hinge axis in the first picture over there, if your hinge axis and osteotomy is at the right point, you will get your axes corrected well and you will get a pure opening wedge. If your hinge axis is at the right level but the osteotomy is either above or lower, you will get translation at the osteotomy. But this is a good translation, because if you look at these, if you look at this picture, the axes are well oriented, and over time, especially in children, once remodeling occurs, you wouldn't even be able to see where this translation had been done. So whether you do this in the diaphysis, whether you do this in the metaphysis, this is a standard sort of a rule that the hinge axis as far as possible should be on the at the level of the cora. The osteotomy for anatomical reasons can vary. So to make a hinge with the Ilizarov, we use a one hole male and female post, and the difference between a one hole and a two hole is that the edges of the one hole are kind of half the thickness of two holes. So when you connect a rod above and below using a one hole, these rods are exactly in the same axis. If you use a two hole, you will tend to offset one set of rings in relation to the other. So when you use it for a hinge, you ideally should use a one hole post. And then you use, you hear this terminology all the time, a lengthening hinge, a shortening hinge, a translational hinge. The hinge is exactly the same. The hinge is just two one hole posts connected to each other. Where you place that hinge is what makes the difference. If your hinge is exactly on the convex border, if your hinge axis rather is exactly on the convex border, you will get an opening wedge. If your hinge axis is further away, you will get a opening wedge as well as lengthening. So this is what is known as a lengthening hinge. And if your hinge axis is away from the area of the deformity, then you get angulation as well as translation. So an oblique plane, as we said, the deformity, when you have a deformity in the AP and a deformity in the lateral, it is not a biplanar, it is just a deformity in a oblique plane, which is oblique in relation to your anatomic planes. And this is what you just saw. When you take an x-ray of this from the front and from the side, you will see a deformity in both, like this clinical example. Right. If you go perpendicular to the plane of the deformity, you will see the maximum deformity, and if you go in the plane of the deformity, you will see. So you can do it, you know, this way, try and find out radiologically, but it's really not required. You can calculate in a relatively simple manner.
So, as we said, what is the relationship of that oblique plane to the hinge axis? The hinge axis should be perpendicular to that oblique plane. So, you have to determine the angulation in the AP and the lateral, determine the cora as well as the magnitude. The cora should be at the same level, as Dr. Unni pointed out, in both of them. If you have one cora higher up and one cora lower down, you are actually dealing with two deformities and not. So, we can now go to the sort of workshop portion of this. We have given you pictures of this deformity, so that you can calculate that deformity. All of you all have these pictures. You can draw a diaphyseal, mid diaphyseal line, which should give you an angulation. I got 24 on the AP and 36 on the lateral. Is that somewhere around what you all are getting? 24 and 36? Anyone wildly different from that? Okay. Yes, go then, I can. That's no. So, the next step is to find what is the oblique plane. Okay. There are multiple ways, you can look up to the screen now. There are multiple ways of finding out. The most accurate ways would be to find out by trigonometry, or there are tables which are given in Ilizarov's books, where if on the AP it's so much, if on the lateral it's so much, then the oblique plane, the magnitude is so much, and the plane is at this orientation, etc. But that's not something which is very user friendly, which you can always do in the clinic. For deformities which are up to 45 degrees in either plane, this graphic method described by Paley is pretty accurate, right? And the way that we go about that is we change the number of degrees to the number of millimeters. Okay, so you'll see two lines which are at right angles to each other, and you see an A, P, M, and L. And how you mark this is depending on which leg it is that you are treating. So you have to look at your own foot, looking at your foot, and what is medial, what is lateral. So which leg am I planning for over here, do you think?
Left.
For the left, because if you put your left leg out, you will find anterior, posterior, medial and lateral, right? Okay. So now this is the center, and we've measured the two angles. Your AP X-ray is measuring the deformity on in which plane, anteroposterior or mediolateral? Mediolateral, right. So whatever you read on the AP X-ray, which is from the front, has to be drawn onto the mediolateral line, and it starts from the center. And depending on where your apex is, so in your example, the apex is medial. So you will draw a line which is 24 millimeters long on the mediolateral line, but towards the medial side. You always start from the center and draw it. Medial, lateral, anterior, posterior, depending on where your apex points. So that is your AP deformity. the AP X-ray. The lateral X-ray is done from the side and it images the sagittal plane. So whatever you see on the lateral X-ray has to be drawn on the AP line, and in this case the apex is anterior, right? So you will draw a line which is how many millimeters? 36 millimeters from the center pointing anterior. So you have now represented your AP and lateral onto this graph. So you now have to find out what is the magnitude of the deformity. We said that whatever you see on the AP and lateral, the true magnitude is always more than what you see on the AP and lateral. And we also have to find out what is the plane of this deformity, right? So you then draw a parallelogram. That is, you draw a line parallel to this medial lateral line at this point, that is at the tip of the arrow, another line parallel to the AP, again at the tip of the arrow. Tip of the arrow designates your, you know, deformity on the AP as well as the lateral. And the length of that diagonal in millimeters tells you the magnitude of the deformity in degrees. So what is the magnitude you all are getting? 40, okay, so 44, 45, 46, how precisely you draw the lines will also have a bearing. So now you see the deformity is actually 47 degrees, and the angle between this red line and the medial lateral line tells you what is the orientation of this oblique plane. You can, depending on how you want to describe it, if you want to describe it in relation to the frontal plane or you want to describe it in relation to the sagittal plane, this angle over here between the red line and the medial frontal or the sagittal. So you can say this is, let us say this looks like around 35, you can measure it. What do you get in relation to the medial lateral line? The orientation of this line, what is this angle? Around 45, 55, okay. Everyone agree with that? Yeah. So that is the orientation of your frame. The other things that we have to find out when we are doing an Ilizarov, usually you are doing an opening wedge, right? And I told you when you do an opening wedge, your hinge axis has to be on the convex side of the bone. Which do you think is the convex side of the bone here? Where the arrow points? You started from the center. Where the arrow points is. So the yellow line is the plane of the deformity. And the convex border is where your arrow points, and the concave border is the opposite side. So whenever you want to do an opening wedge, your hinge axis will have to be somewhere over here, okay? Now, when you want to draw, or rather when you want to plan your hinge axis, suppose I had to correct a procurvatum, you can switch to the camera. Suppose I had to correct a procurvatum deformity as an opening wedge. This is how my hinge axis would need to be, right? If this tibia were bigger, for example, or the placement of my rings was different, then my hinge axis may need to be here. So these things depend on what is the placement of your ring as well as what is the thickness of the tibia or what is the diameter of the tibia. So, when we do this planning, we have to take the AP diameter of the tibia at the level of the osteotomy, and you have to take the this is the AP diameter and this is the medial lateral diameter, right? I'll tell you what is the medial lateral diameter is 30 millimeters. Not on that. I'm giving you the real number here, because angles don't change with your pictures are reduced. Angles won't change, but lengths will change. Medial lateral diameter is 30 mm, and anterior posterior diameter is 40 mm. Okay. Now, if you do a cross section of the tibia, usually you have your medial face which is oblique and your lateral face which is vertical, right? And whenever we put on an Ilizarov ring, one of the sort of conventions is that we center this well over the crest, as you will see on this frame. Okay? So, all the measurements that we do is to the center line, the reason being that the ring is going to be centered onto this crest. So, now if you look at, we can switch to the so you measure your anterior posterior diameter as well as your medial lateral. Now, I said this is going to be the center line. So, how would I draw the outline of the tibia? It would be triangular in this fashion, because the lateral cortex is more or less vertical, the medial cortex is oblique, and my ring etcetera is going to come in relation to this center line, right? So, you can draw this triangle. The medial lateral is 30 and the anterior posterior is 40, and make a seeming, you know, like a cross section over there. Now, there are a couple of other things that you have to do before you start finally making your plan. So, if this is on the AP of this same model. So, I have drawn the proximal axis, I have drawn the distal axis, I have drawn the bisector line, which is the line of the cora. And now, as what we told you earlier, where is the hinge axis going to come? On the convex side, that is over here. Whenever we put on rings, we generally want to put the rings about a hand's breadth away from each other. In the working portion, because that gives you enough stability. At the same time, it gives you enough space to do your work like the osteotomy, etcetera. So, I want a hand's breadth equally distributed above and below this green line. So, on the x-ray itself, you decide your levels of ring fixation. Okay, we are not going to go into the details, but this is the levels of ring fixation, and a sound Ilizarov fixation is equally, if not more important than all of this planning. You have to have a good hold on the bone, otherwise your fixator will correct and the bone will not correct. So, this is the proximal most, which is usually at the level of the head of the fibula. This is the distal most, which is usually within about 5 centimeters from the joint line, and these two rings are a hand's breadth from each other. So, you now know where you want to place your hinge. So, you know the distance between the hinge and ring number 2, you know the distance between hinge and ring number 3, distance between ring number 3, ring number 4, ring number 1, ring number 2. So, this is the concept of pre-construction, and you go in with a frame which is pre-constructed to mimic the deformity that you want to correct. So when we do a straight lengthening, we go with a straight frame. When you have a deformed bone, you go with a deformed frame and confirm that all your lengths are correct. You will still need a little bit of adjustment when you go on table, but usually what we do is we use only two rods in between the rings, so that even when you need to adjust, you are not loosening and tightening too many rods. So I will just take you through this and then we will do it on the model. So this child, you can see on the AP as well as on the lateral, had the cora at the same level, 31 degrees on the AP x-ray, 43 degrees on the lateral, and you see the apex, apex lateral and apex anterior, and this is the left side. So 43 degrees apex anterior, 31 degrees apex medial. So the oblique plane is this, and this is the magnitude, right? This is the plane of the deformity, apex anterolateral. Then you measure the medial lateral dimension, you measure the anteroposterior dimension and transfer that onto your graph. Now usually when we put on an Ilizarov ring, what is the distance we like to have between the skin and the ring? Two finger breadths, right? So this is now the crest of the tibia. And how much do you have in front of the crest of the tibia? A few millimeters, 5 millimeters. There's almost nothing between the crest of the tibia. So you give another 5 millimeters there and put two finger breadths between the anterior crest and whatever ring. And I just told you that we like to orientate the ring such that the two center bolts lie along that central axis. I will show you how we do that on table, okay. Now this is the cross section of my tibia, and which is the convex side? On this side, right. So the most prominent portion of the tibia is likely to be this point where you see the red line intersecting. What we do basically is get a ruler coming from the convex side perpendicular to the plane of the deformity till you just touch the tibia. So if I wanted to have a pure opening wedge, I would use this red line as the hinge axis. Alright, but in this particular case, this child had a little bit of shortening also, and I wanted to have some amount of lengthening. So if I go towards the convex side, I get lengthening. So the dotted line that you see is the line that we chose for the hinge axis. Alright, we will come back to this in a while. As I said, you got to know what is the distance between your rings, and this was the planning that we did for that child. I showed you 4 rings here, but because this is a shorter fragment, it is a child, I went with 1 ring. I know what is this distance, I know what is this distance, frame was pre-constructed. Now if you see this hinge axis, this is one whole anteromedial. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7th hole anterolateral. So we go on with a frame which is as curved as the original, as the bone, and fix that fixator with one wire. You can see the hinges are properly in the right holes. And this is where it is critical to be sort of do the same thing when you do your planning, when you do your x-rays and when you do your execution. We talked about x-rays where you want the patella forward. So when you execute this also, you want the patella forward, because basically what you are doing is recreating that X-ray on table. And this reference wire that we put in, why is this reference wire important? Because I have made this frame, I have made this frame based on a particular length and based on a particular position of this ring. What happens if I put my reference wire over here and then fix the ring to that? My hinge is going to be at the wrong level, it is going to be higher up or lower. So, this one wire is of critical importance, and that is why we call it the reference wire. Everything then follows from that wire. You have to spend a little time getting that wire just right. So, in this particular case, we put in the reference wire. This is how, you know, overall I prefer to use a bunch of towels which I can add, take out as required, and that. So, now we have got one reference wire here and another wire in the distal tibia. This is not a reference wire. We then use the frame itself as a guide to put this wire in. We have got just two wires onto this bone. Okay. But I can look at it from the front, I can look at it from the side and any position in between, and I will notice that everything is reasonably well balanced. Look at the rods in relation to this fragment, they are parallel. Look at the rods in this view in relation to the distal fragment, parallel. Rods over here in relation to this fragment, parallel. So, this is what tells me, and this is the point where if I have to go back, it is easier to go back, adjust the position of my reference wire. So, there are two things I have to look at. I have to look at the level of the hinge and also the rotation. And you have to confirm your hinge level on X-ray, right. Here visually you can see, if you draw the line between these two hinges, it goes through the apex. So, this is 90 degrees to that, and when I go in that plane, I can see that the bone is straight. Suppose my hinges were not put properly, if the bone was rotated in relation to that, I would see some deformity here. So, these are all the cross checks you have to do when you are applying the frame. Come into a lateral and you should be able to see proximal hinge rod, distal hinge rod parallel to the joint, and the center of the hinges directly over the apex. I told you we've used a slightly lengthening hinge, so this is not directly over the apex, this is slightly away. But you can see these are reasonably parallel and this level is right. So, with just these two wires, you can then check that is my frame placed correctly or not. Once the frame is placed correctly, you can go ahead and do the other fixation with wires, pins, etcetera, as may be needed. So, on the AP and lateral in the post-op, you see that the frame is well centered. If you do it perpendicular into the plane, you see it is straight. If you go perpendicular to the plane, again you see the maximum. So, once this is done, then just distracting on one nut is going to correct this deformity without any trouble. And once the bones are complete, once the rings are parallel to each other, you can take out the hinges, put in four straight rods and continue lengthening as much as you want. So, I do not sort of spend too much time trying to see how far away I should be from the bone. I need 4 centimeters of lengthening. So, I need to be 1.5, 2 centimeters. No, I just try to correct it to straight and then continue with lengthening. It is much simpler, and that is what it looks like at the end. You know, both AP as well as lateral views well corrected. So, here you got to see what we call the motor, right. You have two hinges which define a hinge axis, and therefore, to move the rings, you need something which will push it, right. So, where can this motor be? It should be, if the hinges are on the convex side, the motor should be on the concave side. And again there you don't need to sort of think too much about it. You can actually logically, which would be the best place for, sorry, one sec. Yeah. So if this is my hinge axis and this is where one hinge is located, this is where the other hinge is located, where would the motor be best placed? Right in the center, right? And what is right in the center? The plane of the deformity. So wherever the convex portion of the plane of the deformity intersects the ring, that's where you put your hinge. Sorry, concave. On the concave part of the convex is the hinge, and the concave is where the motor is, right? So now you can on your models, you have the AP, you have the lateral. I have gave you the dimensions, and you can draw now the line of the hinges, place your ring along it so that you have the center bolts centered like this, and tell me on which holes I should place the hinges for this deformity, what holes you get, and we'll compare it with what we've done. So who wants to tell me the holes that you have got? Where should the hinge axis be? Hole number 3. Have you kept 2 finger breadths between the ring and the This is the diagram that I got. You can zoom in here. So you have to draw your triangle like this, then keep your 2 fingers in front of that, and then lay your, you have drifted. And then lay your center bolt. Okay, so that's how it has to be, and this line is your hinge axis. That's okay. Good. And now lower.
Mangal, yeah. I have a question. How do you determine the distance of the second and the third ring from the hinge? I mean, how do you determine that? I'm sorry, I missed it somewhere.
Ring number 1 will be here.
That is fine.
Here.
That's the reference.
Ring number 1 will be here. And usually a hand's breadth equally divided above and below the deformity will be ring number.
Okay, so there is
3, 2, and 3.
There is no, I mean, it's okay with just a hand breadth from the hinge. Approximately in hand's breadth below. So there's
no a hand's breadth equally distributed around the deformity. So half a hand's breadth above, half a hand's breadth below. Because you want to have a good stability. If you go too far away, then your hinge rods start bending. And if you get too close, then if it's a big deformity, like you can see in this one, the rings are almost touching.
Right. Thank you.
Sorry. Hi, Mangal. A question. What happens if you have a very gradual curve, if you don't have a sharp angulation?
That's a planning issue. There you have to decide if you, I think Ruta is talking on bowing, so she will tell you that. But you can decide that I want to do this in one kora, that is what do we call a resolution kora, and just correct it. So instead of one big C, you will get 2 small C's, or you can do 2 osteotomies using the line which Unni showed you. Or the extreme version of that, a Sikh kebab is nothing but multiple osteotomies with a rod put inside. So that depends on how technically you are able to do it. If you are comfortable doing, you know, multiple osteotomies, you can do that. That leads to a better anatomic result.
Thank you.
That is a multi-apical deformity. There are multiple apices there.
So you have what do you do in your practice? Do you like use a single cora and do two Cs, or do you do multiples and?
No, usually try to do at least two.
Two.
Two osteotomies.
Oh, okay.
Usual.
Thank you.
I'm Dr. Binu from Bangalore. When you're correcting the angular deformity, would you initially do a little bit of distraction and then correct, or do you correct it straight away?
No, if my hinge placement is right, I don't need to do.
But if you are slow, won't it unite at that junction or something?
In 7 days, it does not unite. So you start distraction at about 7 days.
What is the rate of distraction?
I'll tell you that. There's a way of calculating that. Okay, so has everyone got? What I got was hole number 1 and hole number 11. So who is not clear about this? My hinge axis is here. This is hole number 1 and this is hole number 11. Who doesn't agree with this? Is that clear? Why we have hole number 1 and hole number 11? So if you say hole number 2 and hole number 12, what you've done basically is just moved it a little more that way. But that's fine. I want to ensure that I don't have anything jamming, so I would like to keep it a little on the lengthening side, not a pure. But the concept is, this is the plane of the deformity and this is the plane of the this is the hinge axis. So our hinge axis is number 1 and number 11.
Center.
Ring is that's okay. So hole number 1 and hole number 11. Now, how do we pre-construct the frame? You got to have a block proximally, you got to have a block distally. But I am going to show you with using a single ring. Now, this is the center bolt and we are doing it for the left side. So, this is going to be the medial and that's going to be the lateral. So we said one hole anterolateral, okay. So all of this is done outside theater. This is done the day before surgery, and this really helps. So you can number 1 and 11, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So same thing on this side. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11. Okay, so now ye laga. Right. So we've got a rough hinge construct made up. Okay. You've got to have another ring here and another ring here. But what I want to show you is how we make this oblique plane. So now, this you can see. This is the lateral side. This is the medial side, and this is the center axis. So, if you had a pure procurvatum recurvatum, your axis would go something like this. If you had a pure varus valgus, your axis would go something like this. So, all you have done is you have taken your hinge axis and rotated it around so that it is perpendicular to the plane of the deformity, right. So, the next thing is, as I told you, you have to adjust these hinges. You can't have the hinges one facing this way and another facing this way, then that hinge is not going to move smoothly. So, you have to ensure that both of these hinges are facing well. And if you are a true orthopod, which you know I am sure all of us are, we can decide everything by eyeballing. Ah, that's perfect. But rather than that, it's much easier to pre-construct this, and there is a way of getting this perfectly aligned. So I told you that the distances you have to measure. So I measured about 65 and 80 millimeters, 65 millimeters above and 80 millimeters below. So that has to be actually measured on this. So this one is 65. So I am measuring 65 from the edge of the ring to the center of this hinge. So we get that finger tight. I do the same thing on this side. So basically, actually measuring these rods rather than and this is something which is difficult to do once you have the ring on. So this now, so if your hinges are slightly rotated to each other this way, what all you have to do is turn this 90 degrees. The moment you turn it 90 degrees and hold it like this, these two rod hinge surfaces will be well aligned to each other. And once you have it like this, then you do your final measurement to confirm that this is 85, this is 80. So I need to shorten this a little bit. And then use a spanner to tighten this down. So now this orientation is not going to change. Same thing on the So now I have a hinge which is well aligned and moves smoothly. It's put into the right orientation. finally, what you can do is you can get this. Idharana. Just hold that. Niche se pakadna. On the X-ray, you can get your. This is the AP X-ray. So you see my center bolts are aligned there. You get it so that it is well aligned on your X-ray itself, and tighten the hinge over here. These tighten it into this position. Once you tighten it, the other way of doing it is, what should be the angle between these two rods? What you measured, yeah, the magnitude of deformity. So you can just keep a protractor here, measure the angle between these two and tighten it at this. So the frame then goes into theater with in this deformed position. It is slipped on to the leg, and the right level is confirmed, and then everything is as we showed you, right? So any questions on this part?
It is important to measure the two, as you showed, how much is 38 degrees?
Yeah.
38 degrees. It is
but 48.
48.
46, 48.
That is important. Otherwise, your changes, there will be a lot of changes later on. So your angle must be correct there.
So using that, what we've done is we've put the now when you shoot through the hinges, you can see that the level of the hinges in relation to the apex of the deformity is also correct. Now if I turn it around so that the hinges are, your bone should appear straight. These two things tell me that yes, my frame is properly balanced. What could happen? I put my reference wire a little too high, a little too low, and when I take this view, I find that the hinges are either above or below. If that is the case, you can always take out the reference wire, put it into the right position. That is the easiest way of doing it. Or you could loosen these nuts and move the hinges a little more distal or a little more proximal. Personally, I prefer changing the reference wire. But once this is done, then you can do all your sort of additional fixation. Once you ensured that, now you will see here that we are a little more than convex, so we are going to get, when we correct the deformity, we are going to get lengthening. And the idhar jara zoom karna, sorry, on this one. Isme aur hai kya? Nylock nuts hai aur dena. When we use it, when we use these nuts on a hinge, you got to have it so that it can rotate. When we use standard nuts, you have to tighten them completely. If you use a standard nut over here and leave it slightly loose, over time it just kind of, you know, gets loose. So there is a special kind of nut, either agar zoom in hota hai, what we call a nylock nut. Basically it's got a nylon insert. So it tightens just so much, and you can leave it loose, it will not back out. Can you zoom in on this? I don't know whether. Unlike other nuts, there's a little bit a ring of nylon in that there, yeah. So that basically prevents it from moving. So we tighten it down and then back off by about. So we tighten it fully and then back off by half a turn. So now you see when I'm moving this nut, even the when I'm moving the bolt, even the nut is moving. And you need a similar kind of nut over here, because as you distract this, this is going to change. This is where we put in the motor. When we put in the motor, normally what I prefer to use is a rod which has got a nut above and what we call a square nut or a close encounter nut below. That has four sides. It's much easier for, and this is the only nut that the patient has to turn. So, you know, one side, two, four times a day on a four-sided nut is much easier than four times a day on a six-sided nut. So, I'm going to now show you an accelerated version of the correction. So, as you now distract this, you get, and the rods are straight, the bone looks pretty straight on the lateral as well as on the AP. Okay. So, what is critical is placement of your hinges. And that brings us to the question of how do you decide your rate of distraction, right? You want 1 millimeter of distraction per day happening over here. Okay, this is the area which is traveling the fastest. But 1 millimeter of distraction over here does not mean 1 millimeter of distraction here. If this distraction rod were further away, that ratio would change. So, there is something known as the rule of triangles, the rule of similar triangles, where whatever is the distance to be moved here, this the ratio between the hinges to this rod, okay, and the distance between the hinges to the convex portion. Normally, it turns out to be a ratio of 1:3 or 1:4. So, 3 or 4 millimeters of distraction on this per day will lead to 1 millimeter of distraction over here. So, you have to get an X-ray which is in this position and measure the distance between hinges and motor and hinges and concave border of the bone. So, the ratio between the two will give you how much distraction has to happen on the motor to give you 1 millimeter of distraction per day at the concave portion. Any questions? So, oblique plane is something which is not very difficult to correct with a single hinge. But many a times what happens is you get an oblique plane along with rotation, number one. Or as you see in this, I did all the planning and all that, admittedly a little rough, but you, if you know, look clearly, there is a little bit of translation, right? So if you are one of those who wants to get this perfectly straight, then you have to put in what's known as a translation device, move it a little posterior, anterior, medial, lateral, and things like that. So the advantage of any six-axis system, and this is the six-axis system which is available here now at sort of Indian cost. You can zoom in on this one. All six-axis systems are essentially the same. One, it's like all of them are like it's like the knee guys. You know, Depew will say my knee is better. Zimmer will say my knee is better. The principle is exactly the same. There are these six connectors between the two rings, which will allow you to change angulation in AP, lateral, or any plane in between, which will allow you to lengthen, shorten, and rotate without a change of hardware. That is what is the basic thing. You still have to plan. You still have to plan, right? So that still goes by the GIGO principle, garbage in, garbage out. So you have to plan, but this allows you to do your, you know, carry out your plans without too much of trouble. So I'll show you one adult case because that has all the components. This guy fell off and he had multiple fractures. He had a head injury because of which he was unconscious for a while. People were not sure what is to be done. Ultimately, he came to us with this kind of injury on his left tibia. The right side was reasonably okay. And that's what it looked like on the lateral. He had a definite rotational component to his deformity. He was shorter. So there was this intra-articular fracture which was reasonably well aligned. It wasn't terrible, and I think getting alignment over here is more important. He had this metafascial varus and a mid-shaft valgus. There was distal valgus in this fracture over here, and his ankle was fused. On the lateral view, he had this proximal recurvatum. He had procurvatum in the mid-shaft, and as a consequence, we say 2 A's is equal to 1 T. He had this translation. 2 angulations is equal to 1 translation. So effectively, the distal fragment was translated in the front. Now, if you do the planning, which is, we talked about the proximal axis, what we want to do ultimately is get this ankle in line with the femoral axis. So you draw the femoral axis from the center of the head, center of the knee, and extend it downwards. This becomes your proximal axis. And then through the center of the ankle up the tibia is your distal axis. So this gives you what we call a resolution cora. You don't have to kind of look at each and every deviation of that. If you do the osteotomy here and straighten it, overall the axis of this leg is going to be well aligned. But what is happening on, so this is where your cora or your hinge axis is going to be. But what about the lateral? That's the proximal axis. This is the distal axis, and that intersects over here. So in this case, we drew a third line to get a cora point at the same level on the lateral as it was on the AP. And because it wasn't really very much visible, and displacements in the sagittal plane don't have as much of an effect as displacements or angulations in the coronal. So we decided to do the osteotomy here. So that's where on the lateral, and that's where it is on the AP. So he had all of these deformities, and this is what it looks like. So this does not take away from the principles of Ilizarov. Whether you use a Taylor spatial frame, whether you use a hexapod, whether you use anything, the principles of stable internal stable external fixation still remain. This is just a toy that you can use to manipulate the rings. And so we put on these 6 struts. This is the internal rotation, that is the level of the osteotomy, and what these things require, because it is such a complex movement, any 6 axis system requires software to tell you, you know, how it has to be distracted. So, and this software has got one sort of good not version, it has got a good feature that it shows you. You see the yellow outline and the red outline. The yellow outline is outline which you make of the distal fragment, and the red outline is what the software then projects that at the end of this correction what it is going to look like. So you get a visual cue as to how things are going to improve. So you can see that the axis is more or less corrected on this, and even on the lateral, though it is anteriorly translated, the axis is corrected. So this is what we planned for. We planned to correct all his valgus, recurvatum, some of his rotation and some of the shortening. That is, he had about 60 mm of shortening. There are hiccups for which there are solutions. Then we did a second sort of stage. You don't necessarily have to do everything together. You get fresh x-rays done, and whatever it needs to be fine-tuned, lengthening, rotation, etc., we do that. So that is his second plan, which was for 35 days. And by the end of that, we had all his rotation corrected. He was still short by 3 centimeters. Mechanical axis deviation was going through the lateral condyle, so that needed to be straightened up a little. So all of that minor sort of corrections were done. So that is the progress of his frontal correction, rotation, and that is the final sort of alignment that was achieved. And the advantage of a 6 axis over a regular Ilizarov, especially when there is a large amount of rotation, is that when you do an Ilizarov distraction or even a angular correction and you get a nice tube and then you rotate that, there is to a certain extent there is a wringing out of that tube, and you can have trouble with regenerate sort of ossifying, number one. Number two is, because in the tibia, the tibia is never centered in the ring. So whenever you do a rotation, you also get a certain amount of translation. But when you use a 6 axis system, you can define the axis of rotation as being within the tibia. So whatever rotation happens, happens there, and you don't get the tibia translated, you get the rings which relatively translate to each other, which you will see. And finally, is that with a 6 axis, it goes from point to point, point A to point B in sort of one straight line. So it is still, even while you are rotating, it is distracting. So that gives you a much better regenerate, which this is what he had. So now you see his rings are not all that parallel to each other. You see the lower rings are kind of displaced to one side, and we take those off, and using the various, you know, the modularity of the Ilizarov, you connect the proximal set of rings to the distal set of rings. Things heal up pretty well, and this was at the time of removal of the fixator. This is 2 months post removal. So now if you ignore all this wavy stuff, proximal to distal well aligned, proximal to distal well aligned, though anteriorly translated, but that is a conscious decision that we took, you know. So 6 axis basically can do everything that an Ilizarov does, but it comes into its own, so to speak, when there is rotation involved, number one. Number two, when, especially in the pediatric situation, when your osteotomies often cannot be at the level of the cora. The cora tends to be at the epiphysis, and your osteotomy has to be usually lower down. In that case, there has to be a certain amount of translation. If you are very comfortable with the use of hinges, of course you can put your hinges for an angular deformity and correct that. But if you use a 6 axis, that becomes a little simpler. But again, it is not the cure for all your, you know, maladies. It's only a tool. You still have to know all the planning principles to decide where is the cora, to decide where am I going to do the osteotomy. This thing will just allow you to use an Ilizarov fixator with a little more ease. Thank you.
I would request Dr. Sriram to hand over a small memento to Dr. Mangal Parihar.
Thank you, sir.